Welcome to this online service from the churches of St Mary's, Charlcombe and St Stephen's, Lansdown on the northern slopes of Bath in England. My name is Reverend Andrew Avramenko. I'm the curate and priest at both churches. Sadly, the Reverend Debbie Powell, who was due to bring you this service, is ill with COVID at the moment. We'll pray for Debbie and all who are in need of our prayers later. She had great plans for the service, but I hope what I will have to offer you will be of help in your worship today. It being Palm Sunday, this service will have a slightly different order to usual. We will start with an opening prayer, the collect for Palm Sunday, before watching a short video, having a homily, a short sermon, and then having the Passion reading, and ending with our prayers of intercession and a blessing. And so, our opening prayer, the collect for today. Lord of the swaying palms, the stones of the earth, the beasts of burden, bear witness to your coming. Lead us from the violence of empire and the collusion of crowds to a heart of flesh, a world remade and a new song for all creation, through Jesus Christ, the crucified God. Amen. Let's hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethpage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent to the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it, and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you are untying it, just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to praise God joyfully and with a loud voice for all the deeds of power they had been seeing, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory to the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." Jesus answered them, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise you, O Christ. So now we're going to watch a short video before I bring you a short sermon.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Father God, may the words that I speak be the words that you want me to speak. May the words that are heard be the words that you want to be heard. I ask this in the name of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We've just seen some models and musicians, actors and other celebrities make their grand entrance. Today, on Palm Sunday, we remember Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem, an entrance which began the week which ended in his crucifixion. And I wonder, have you ever noticed how Jesus often manages to do the expected and the unexpected at the same time? Those on the lookout for the Messiah 2,000 years ago might have expected him to arrive on the donkey. It had been prophesied. The book of Zechariah says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he. Humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So they might have expected Jesus to arrive on the donkey. Yet when he did, few realised what they were seeing. Jesus was what went for a celebrity in his day. There was no Twitter, Facebook, Instagram or Snapchat to spread a message or to get your fix of news and entertainment. Jesus' social media was old school word of mouth. Those that saw, heard or were healed by Jesus told their friends and family about it. Who told their friends and family about it? Who told their friends and family about it? Who told... Well, you get it. Words got out that Jesus was coming into Jerusalem. Most people wouldn't have known what Jesus looked like. There weren't cameras after all. But it wouldn't have taken them long to figure out who he was. A man upon a donkey, encircled, led and followed by an entourage, would have drawn people's curiosity at the very least. Crowds gathered. Some were desperate to get some of the healing that they had heard about. Some were curious to see this person that they had heard about. And some would have been annoyed that he and the crowds that were being drawn to him were disrupting their Passover celebrations. Some in Jerusalem would have been suspicious, fearful and even angry. Here he was, a saviour and a threat, being celebrated and cheered, sneered and being welcomed. We might have think that we know the actors, models and musicians who make their grand entrances, but we generally don't know what's going on in their lives. When we see actors on the red carpet or musicians rocking out on the stage, we see only what's on the surface. We don't see what's going on in their mind or on their heart. It was similar for the crowd watching Jesus. The crowd in Jerusalem would have seen a person seemingly at ease with being the centre of attention, but they wouldn't have seen the full picture of the person before them. They wouldn't have seen or known what was on Jesus' mind. He might have been smiling on the outside, but on the inside he was wrestling with the mission God had given him. The crowd could not see what Jesus could see ahead of him, the cross. The cross weighed heavily on Jesus before he was forced to carry it. The image we see when we look at someone is not the full picture. Our thoughts, our feelings, and much of what we do is often hidden. People may view you as an ordinary child, a run-of-the-mill office worker, a stereotypical pensioner with panache, or a parent with too much to do. But that's not your true identity. You are a child of God. You may have declared your identity, certainly if you've been baptised you have, and you may have declared it since that day. But to many, your identity is hidden. You're a secret agent without an Aston Martin. You're a superhero with your underwear on the inside. You may not be able to fly or shoot webs. You may not have to face a villain like Vladimir Putin, but God considers you to be essential to his grand plan. The crowd didn't know what was going on inside of Jesus, and don't know what's going on in each other's minds, just as we don't to this day. We might be smiling on the outside, but struggling on the inside. We might seem to be confident go-getters to our friends, but secretly are apprehensive and doubt our abilities. God knows what's going on inside of you and what is inside of you. He knows your gifts and talents. He doesn't doubt your abilities. He knows your potential, and he's given you a mission to achieve it. Just as God had set a mission for Jesus, so God has set a tailor-made mission inside each one of us. Jesus knew what he had to do, and he knew God would help him achieve it. I wonder whether you know what your mission is. I wonder whether this Lent you have found out what God is asking you to do. This Holy Week, that begins today, is a good week to listen to God and to decode the message he is trying to tell you. But as you listen, know that like Jesus, you are not alone on your mission. Like Jesus had Simon, you have God to provide the strength you need. Like Jesus, you have people around you. He had the disciples. You have the church and your friends and family. And thanks to Jesus completing his mission, you can have the Holy Spirit with you too. Amen. And now we're going to have an extended reading, the Passion of Christ, taken from Luke's Gospel. It speaks of what happens in the week ahead for Jesus and the week that we will remember as we go on between now and Easter Sunday. So let us hear the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to be to thee, O Lord. When the hour came, Jesus took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, I have eagerly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. But for the Son of Man is going as it has been determined. But woe to that one by whom he is being betrayed. Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be who would do this. A dispute also rose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them, the king of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors, but not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? but I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom. A kingdom so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on the thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, listen. Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail, and you, when once you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. And he said to him, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter, the cock will not crow this day until you have denied three times that you know me. Jesus said to them, when I sent you out without a purse, a bag, or sandals, did you lack anything? They said, no, not a thing. He said to them, but now, the one who has a purse must take it, and likewise a bag, and the one who has no sword must sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you, the scripture must be fulfilled in me. And he was counted among the lawless. And indeed, what is written about me is being fulfilled. They said, Lord, look, here are two swords. He replied, it is enough. Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, pray that you may not come into the time of trial. Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down upon the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. While Jesus was speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man? When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked, Lord, should we strike with the sword? Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, no more of this. And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police and the elders who had come for him, have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour, the power of darkness. Then they seized Jesus and led him away, bringing him to the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then the servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, this man was also with him. But he denied it, saying to the lady, woman, I do not know him. A little later, someone else said, on seeing Peter, you are also one of them. But Peter said, man, I am not. And then, about an hour later, yet another kept on insisting, Surely this man was also with him, for he is a Galilean. But Peter said, Man, I do not know what you are talking about. And at that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord and how he had said to him, Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking, Prophesy, who is it that struck you? They kept heaping many other insults on him. When the day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said, If you are the Messiah, tell us. He replied, If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. All of them asked, Are you then the Son of God? He said to them, You say that I am. Then they said, What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips. Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, We have found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king. Then Pilate asked him, Are you the king of the Jews? He answered, If you say so. Then Pilate said to the chief priests, And the king crowds, I find no basis for an accusation against this man. But they were insistent and said, He stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began to even to this place. When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad because he had been wanting to see him for a long time. He had heard about him and was hoping to see Jesus perform some sign. Herod questioned Jesus at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put on an elegant robe on Jesus and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people. And here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and released. Then they all shouted out together, Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us! Barabbas was a man who'd been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting, Crucify! Crucify him! A third time they said to him, Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no grounds for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him. But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man that they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished. As they led Jesus away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross upon him. They made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified there Jesus with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching. But the leader scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." And there was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hanged there with him kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, when the sun's light failed and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was a day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath day they rested, according to the commandment. That was the passion of the Lord. Praise to thee, O Christ. Let us now pray our prayers of intercession. We stand with Christ in his suffering, for forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For grace to seek out those habits of sin which mean spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Christian people, that through the suffering of disunity, there may grow a rich union in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who make laws, interpret them and administer them, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who still make Jerusalem a battleground, let us pray to the Lord. For those who have the courage and honesty to work openly for justice and peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in darkness and agony of isolation, that they may find support and encouragement, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who weigh down with hardship, failure or sorrow, who feel that God is far from them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who are tempted to give up the way of the cross, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And now we stand with Ukraine in their suffering. God of all nations, we cry to you for the people of Ukraine. We thank you for their roots, identity and courage in the face of such aggression. We pray for President Volodymyr Zelensky and President Vladimir Putin and both their governments. Thwart evil power. Direct hearts to peace and mercy and give wisdom to other governments to know how to help Ukraine and avoid escalation. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, Prince of Peace, we pray for our sisters and brothers in the church in Ukraine. Give them strength and resilience in this crisis to proclaim the good news of your kingdom. Bind up broken hearts and bring comfort to all who mourn. Lord, have mercy. holy God. You make wars cease to the ends of the earth. You break bows, shatter spears. You are our rock, our fortress, and our deliverer. Our hope is in you. We pray you save the lives of Ukrainians and Russians alike. Lord, have mercy. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. Amen. Peace to you from God our Father, who hears our cry. Peace from his Son, Jesus Christ, whose death brings healing. Peace from the Holy Spirit, who gives life and strength. And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Comforter, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. I pray that this Holy Week will be special to you. Look forward to seeing you again soon. Take care. God bless. Goodbye.